Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to the Lord's house on this beautiful Sunday morning. It's good to have you here as we can worship and have fun together. There are a number of announcements that I'd like to make at this time. One is that the next Sunday, the worship service will have Pastor Karen Minnis preaching, and the band Predestined will be playing. So we're in for a real treat. The Wednesday Bible study, that's Christmas Day, so I don't think we're going to have that. And I didn't think we were having our Tuesday Bible study either, although I'll be here anyway, so if you want to come, feel free. Don't forget the deacons and selling their poinsettias. Our Christmas Eve candlelight service will begin at 5 p.m. on Tuesday, December 4th. There will be soup and fellowship following the service for all the rest of you. Bring some finger food and celebrate the Savior's birth. And we should, as another reminder, because most of us are great procrastinators, myself included, remember your annual reports, those of you in session. Bob is patiently waiting. Are there any other announcements that we need to make at this time? Seeing none, then we'll prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we sing a Christmas carol today.
And I have had a request for number 82, Let All Mortal Flesh Be Silent.
Blessing in his God's act of faith at Christmas is to rely on humankind for the plan to work. Our act of faith is to say yes. We confess, God, that unlike Joseph, we probably wouldn't have said yes, that we probably would have scoffed at the question. We confess that if the plan had relied on us, it probably would have failed. We confess that we do not believe the impossible can happen, that we mostly think that this whole idea of Christmas has no grounding in reality. In our defense, though, we have good reason to doubt. Let us pray. This Christmas, God, bring the angels that speak to us rumors of hope and life. We are willing to be convinced. Amen. Now let us join together and sing verse 3 of O Come, O Come, Emmanuel.
Please join me in today's responsive call to worship. We are always looking for evidence that God is with us.
That Son is the one to come, the one that God is sending.
We want to know for sure that everything is in God's care.
And so we cry to the heavens in our distress. Our cries are heard. God is responding in love and hope.
Let us come before God with expectant hearts and spirits.
Let us be ready to receive
the blessed gift of the Savior. Amen. Please remain standing as we sing opening hymn number 99, Angels We Have Heard on High.
Oh.
You may be seated. Now please join, now please open up to your little brown books and join me in reading the responsive reading, number 60. Jesus was born in the town of Bethlehem in Judea during the reign of King Herod.
About that time, some astrologers from eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem asking, "Where is the newborn king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in far off eastern lands and have come to worship him."
King Herod was deeply disturbed by their question, and all Jerusalem was filled with rumors. He called a meeting of the Jewish religious leaders.
"Did the prophets tell us where the Messiah would be born?" he asked.
"Yes, in Bethlehem," they said, "for this is what the prophet Micah wrote.
O little town of Bethlehem, you are not just an unimportant Judean village, for a governor shall rise from you to rule my people Israel."
Then Herod sent a private message to the astrologers, asking them to come see him. At this meeting, he found out from them the exact time when they first saw the star.
Then he told them, "Go to Bethlehem and search for the child, and when you find him, come back and tell me so that I can go and worship him too."
After this interview, the astrologers started out again. And look, the star appeared to them again, standing over Bethlehem. Their joy knew no bounds.
Entering the house where the baby and Mary his mother were, they threw themselves down before him, worshiping. Then they opened their presents and gave him gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
But when they returned to their own land, they didn't go through Jerusalem to report to Herod, for God had warned them in a dream to go home another way.
After they were gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. "Get up and flee to Egypt with the baby and his mother," the angel said, "and stay there until I tell you to return, for King Herod is going to try to kill the child."
That same night, he left for Egypt with Mary and the baby and stayed there until King Herod's death.
"This fulfilled the prophet's prediction. I have called my son from Egypt."
The proof of God's amazing love is this: while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. In faith and penitence, let us confess our sin before God and one another, as we first confess our sins together using the unison prayer printed in your bulletin, and then by coming silently before the throne of God as individuals. Let us pray. O holy God of promise, we so often place our trust in the things we can see and touch and easily believe. But you did not ask us to believe what is easy. You have asked us to believe what is true. Forgive us, Holy One, when we doubt the ways you work. Forgive us when we find it hard to believe in an ancient story, even though we know it is true. Forgive us when we ask to enter the world, born as one of us. Forgive our lack of faith and belief in ways which we deem so impossible to believe. Help us to look in faith, open our belief, and set aside our doubts that you sent your Son, born of a virgin, who has come to set us all free. We offer these prayers in the name of your Son, Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. And Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone, a new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Please join me in our unison prayer for illumination. Holy Spirit, Holy Word, may your love leap within us and your stories seal themselves to our hearts. As we prepare to welcome Jesus Christ, may we first welcome your wisdom to our worship. Amen. The first of our scripture readings comes from Genesis 12, verses 1 through 7. We don't know why God chose Abraham to bless and to make into a great nation. We don't know what Abraham thought of the extraordinary things God told him and asked to do, or what kind of questions he asked himself as he thought about his life-changing decision. But we know that he did trust God and followed his leading across hundreds of miles and into a land and people far from home. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 7. The Lord said to Abram, "Leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram left, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. He took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, all the possessions they had accumulated, and the people they had acquired in Haran. And they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. Abram traveled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At the time, the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring I will give you this land." So he built an altar there to the Lord who had appeared to him. Our New Testament reading comes from Matthew 1, verses 18 through 25. Just as people in Abraham's hometown probably thought he was crazy to follow God the way he did, people who knew Joseph may have thought he was a fool to take Mary as his wife when she was already pregnant. If he had told them that God had told him in a dream that Mary's son had been conceived by the Holy Spirit, they might have thought he really was losing his mind. But like Abraham, Joseph believed what God had said and trusted in God to keep his extraordinary promises. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today, as we look at the Gospel of Matthew, we get to see someone who really doesn't get a whole lot of press, as it were, in the Scriptures. And that is Joseph. He has no speaking parts. Even in this passage, he says nothing. He must have been the strong, silent type. But Joseph was critical to God's plan for salvation. And I want to bring to your attention some of the traits and practices that Joseph had that made him such a unique individual and someone that we can look to and emulate, not just during this time of Advent and Christmas, but even beyond. Now, Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, or betrothed. But before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. So, the way the Jews do this is they generally had a one-year-long betrothal. They were considered married during that time. If Joseph had died, she would gain inheritance. If, as was seen later on in the passage, if they chose to separate, then they had to go through a divorce. During this time, she would usually live with her parents, but would be spending a lot of time at Joseph's home to learn, generally from his mom, how to take care of him properly. And so we look at this time, and Mary was young. She was a maiden. And she was found to be pregnant. Now, as far as the people are concerned, and as far as Joseph was concerned initially, there's only one reason why that could happen. That was that she was unfaithful to Joseph. Or that Joseph had broken his own vows in terms of the betrothal, because he wasn't supposed to consummate it until they actually had the wedding ceremony. So what you have is someone who is either an adulteress, which could be mean that she could be stoned, and in fact that's what it called for in the law, or Joseph had no self-control. Now, this was a small town. Nazareth only had about 300 people in it. Everybody knew everybody. You guys wouldn't know about that. And Joseph was a carpenter. He had a business, a small business that he ran himself. He had a reputation in the town. It says he was a righteous man. He, by the way, is only one of two people that's called righteous in the scriptures. He very definitely followed the law. Some translations say he was a just man. He was very good at following the law that had been set out, the law of Moses. He was somebody that showed goodness to his neighbor, taking care of them, taking care of his family. He did all the right things. As far as the people were concerned, you couldn't have a better role model until now. If he had no self-control, then that just shoots down his reputation entirely. If he had, as he did, married Mary anyways when she was an adulteress, then he would be seen as a fool. What man takes spoiled goods, as it were? Remember, they had a lower opinion of women than we do today. His reputation would be shot. His business was probably impacted negatively. His place in the synagogue, the local synagogue, was probably would get rid, be gotten rid of. He would have to move back. I know that we start in the back, and I have to encourage people to move forward. But, you know, in those days, they sat in the front. And then as you went back, you were further away from the teacher. And so that was a sign of not being educated and not wanting to learn. So, you know, if you all come and sit forward, then I'll know that you really want to hear what I have to say. But Joseph was a just man, and he was a righteous man. And he chose then, he did not want to expose Mary to public disgrace, which would lead to stoning. So he had in mind to divorce her quietly. Now, they could do that. Again, since they were already betrothed, considered married by the law, he had to divorce her. But they also had a rule that he could write his own writ of divorce and in front of two witnesses say, I divorce thee, I divorce thee, I divorce thee. And she had to go back home to her parents. Again, their view on women was they were second-class citizens. The woman couldn't do the same thing to the man unless he was actually an adulterer, and they could prove it. So he was going to put her aside quietly and just send her back to her parents. And so he was doing actually her a favor. He was showing compassion to her. He had every right to be angry. Wouldn't you be angry if you had a spouse and you found they were cheating on you, even before you had a chance to be with them? As he was considering this, it says, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife. Now, this is subtle, but I find this interesting. What is the first thing that angels usually say when they meet a human being? Do not be afraid. In other words, don't be afraid of me, the angel. Joseph was apparently not afraid. Because what the angel tells him is, don't be afraid to take Mary home. He doesn't say, fear not, for I have a message for you from God. He shows up in Joseph's dreams, much as he did to Abraham and Jacob and many of the others, and says, don't be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. Now, again, as Al had noted, most people would consider the word of being conceived from the Holy Spirit, and if he'd gone around and told people that, then they would have thought he was a nutcase. If Mary had tried to tell that to Joseph before the dream, he probably would have thought she was a nutcase. The Holy Spirit, though, in Jewish tradition and understanding, did interact with people and exercise power over them. Every prophet, thus saith the Lord, or the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. King David, who was known to have the Spirit of God with him, did many things. So when an angel tells you the child is conceived by the Holy Spirit, then it's not so far-fetched. But there's still the question of, what about me, Joseph? What about my reputation? What about my desires? What about my business? What about providing for her later on? What about me? The angel says she'll give birth to a son, and you're to give him the name Jesus, Joshua, because he will save his people from their sins. And that is great. What a message. They've been waiting for the Messiah to come. And the saving from the sins was actually kind of secondary, because it said that he would make everybody perfect, so there would be no more sin in the world, so therefore he would save them from their sins, from their perspective. So he's got this message that, yay, the Messiah is coming. But still, what am I supposed to do? You're telling me that Mary's giving birth to the Messiah? Assuming that she's giving a normal birth, that means it's a baby. What am I supposed to do with the Son of God? We know Mary asked herself similar things, but she, in her Magnificat, pledges herself as she considers these things and sets herself at God's to fulfill God's desires. Joseph doesn't say anything. But this had to be running through his head. Joseph wasn't apparently much of a speaker. but it becomes obvious that he was a doer. And let me tell you some of the things that he did. There couldn't have been a better father other than God the Father himself for Jesus. First of all, he said yes to God, as noted in our Advent reading today. He took Mary home with him, though he didn't have to. He took care of her, and when the time came to go to Bethlehem, he took her with him as his wife. After the baby was born and the wise men came, he had a dream again, and he was directed to go to Egypt. Now, Egypt's a lot further from Jerusalem than Nazareth is from Bethlehem. And yet he did it. Packed up his stuff, rooted up whatever business he'd set up in Bethlehem for the last couple years, went down to Egypt, took care of the family down there for another 6 to 7 years, brought Jesus back when he was about 8 years old to Nazareth. Remember, small town, long memories. Even if there were other brothers and sisters by now, and we know that Jesus had brothers and sisters in the last 8 years, and so that Joseph came back as a family man, they would have remembered what happened with the first one. We know that they remember because later on in Jesus' life and ministry, some of the Pharisees sort of mock him or try to discredit him as someone who doesn't even know who his own father is when he talks about them not knowing their father in heaven. They know he's what they would consider to be a bastard, an illegitimate child. So even though he brought him back to Nazareth, his hometown, put up with the social ostracization, the difficulties in starting the business up again, took care of his son and the rest of his family, brought him up right, taught him the business. He was a good carpenter, a good tecton. Taught him apparently compassion, because Jesus showed compassion. And it wasn't just because he was deific, that is, he had a nature of God in him. He showed it humanly as well, in his ability to cry with people and to have compassion on them when they were hungry. He taught Jesus the scriptures. You know, Jesus wasn't born knowing the Bible. I mean, yes, his godly side did, but he had sort of locked that away while he was incarnate. But we know from Luke that when he was 12 years old, he was in the temple when his parents lost him for a couple days. He was in the temple and he was teaching the rabbis. He was responding to them and having dialogue with them, and they were all amazed. And afterwards, it says that he grew in wisdom and in the spirit, Luke says. Now you grow in those two things as you mature in your faith. And we know that the way you mature in your faith is one of two different ways. One is experience, and the other is study. So Joseph taught Jesus all the basics that he needed to know. Presumably, even after he died, then Jesus continued his studies so that by the time he was 30, he knew completely and totally who he was and what God the Father wanted from him. He was ready to go out into ministry. He was always able to respond to his critics with the word, with scriptures. Even the devil himself, it says, scripture says. That's how he would respond. So Joseph came up to the challenge. As he taught Jesus how to be the best human being that he could be, and gave him the room for his godly nature come forth and develop. Now, it's hard enough raising kids that are just human. We know that Jesus didn't sin even as a kid, though he probably exasperated his parents a few times. But he still had to learn. He still had to grow. And it was Joseph that provided those opportunities. So this man who says nothing did a whole lot. He did something. And that something was everything for Christ to become the man that he was. So when you read the story, yes, we want to appreciate Mary, absolutely. We don't need to venerate them like some of the Catholics do, but her like some of the Catholics do, but we certainly want to understand and praise her for what she did and what she went through. But we also need to recognize Joseph. And we need to understand the challenge that he had so that we can give praise to God. See, God knew. It was all in God's hands, and that means we can trust God too. He will provide whatever we need, be it a mentor, be it someone to mentor, be it an opportunity to learn the scriptures. Or, although it can be painful at times, much as it was for them, an experience to help us grow in wisdom. It's a lifelong trust that we need to place in God. And when we do so, then we make an impact beyond what we could ever know. I doubt Joseph ever thought, even knowing his son was the Savior, that he would be memorialized forever in the Word of God. I don't think that was one of his concerns. You'll make that same kind of impact with others if you're faithful and follow him. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Our hymn, if you would turn to it, is number 130, That Beautiful Name. giver of all good gifts, bless the offering we make this morning, a small token to all the blessings you have poured down on us. Into our human weakness, you gave the greatest gift of all, Emmanuel, your presence with us in Jesus Christ. Not just a presence, but an invitation through him to be your children and heirs to your kingdom. May our gifts, hymns, prayers, and promises help us realize that kingdom in our hearts and in our world. As the ushers come forward to take the morning offering, may you meditate on God's blessings in your life that you give joyfully and generously to the work of his church here in Morning Sun. And we also are going to be singing a Christmas carol that is a congregational choice. So if someone would like to call out a number.
135.
There's a song in the air. Join me in the unison prayer of dedication. It may not be incense, gold, or myrrh that we have given, Lord. Still, we thank you for how you are at work in us. Guide us with wisdom and courage to make good use of the gifts you have given. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. One of the joys and privileges we have as Reformed believers is praying for and with each other, knowing that we shall be heard by God through our High Priest, Jesus Christ. There are lots of people listed for concerns and joys. Are there others that you would like to bring to our attention at this time? Yes, Fran.
I'm Jim Tannis, one of my truck drivers in the Patriarch, from a very good family. And he missed out getting out of his truck and fell down to the ground and broke 4 ribs. And he's been sleeping in his recliner for a month now. He isn't getting around very good, but everybody's praying for him. And I'd like for you guys to also recover.
How do you spell his name?
T-I-N-N-E-S.
Oh, E-S, okay. Any other joys or concerns? I know that, or last I knew, Doris is at home, so she seems to be doing better.
We're out there Thursday.
Good.
I talked to her yesterday, and she says she has kind of a tingling in her arm otherwise, and sometimes she wants to pick things up in a certain way. So just weakness, I think.
But she's recovering, so. Are there other joys or concerns? Then let's come before God in prayer, knowing that he knows our needs better than we do ourselves, and he delights in answering the prayers of his people according to his will. God our Father, creator of the universe, giver of every breath we take, we praise and we glorify you. You are such an awesome God. You are all-powerful. You are all-knowing. You place the stars in the sky. You know them all by name. You know us better than we know ourselves. There's no place we can escape from you. There's no place we can hide from your eyes. Lord, you see deeply into us, even deeper than we can see ourselves, into those places that we hide from ourselves and we are ashamed. Because those places are usually places where we are in rebellion to you. And Lord, our sin has set us apart from you. But we give you thanks that in your wisdom and your love, you made a way for us to be reconciled to you, to be brought back into relationship with you, to have your image within us healed and made whole once again. Lord, we give you thanks and praise that you did for us what we could not do for ourselves. And when the time was right, Jesus came to earth. He was born as a child. He lived among us, growing up, taught us, suffered and died for us to cleanse us of our sins, and then was raised again so that we might become new creatures, so that we might have new life in him, eternal life in heaven and abundant life here on earth. And we give you thanks and praise for that greatest of all gifts. Lord, we ask that the healing that you've placed in our lives would continue and it would occur in the lives of others, whether it be spiritual, physical, or mental. Lord, make people whole to serve your purposes and your will. We offer special prayers for Doris as she is recovering from her strokes, for Jim Tanis, who fell out of the truck and at least broke 4 ribs. May you strengthen their bodies, their minds, and their spirits as they continue to recover, so that they might once again be fully able to pursue your will for them. And Lord, this time of year is rough for many of us. We pray for those who have lost loved ones in particularly, that you would strengthen their spirits, give them that peace that passes all understanding that only comes from you. May we keep our eyes fixed on you and the promise that you have fulfilled for us in Jesus Christ, that one day we shall see those loved ones again, that one day we shall celebrate together if we believe in you. And Jesus, Prince of Peace, come back soon. Bring your peace to the entire world as every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that you are Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Holy Spirit, be with us until that time. Give us the wisdom to see what you are telling us to do. Give us the courage of heart to say yes and to move forward without fear, being vulnerable, risking rejection. And give us the perseverance of spirit to complete the tasks you have for us, to overcome the obstacles the world will place before us, so that one day we hear those words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." And Holy Spirit, be poured out upon this church. Expand its boundaries and ministries. Keep it from evil. Lord, may it be a light in the darkness of this world, one that brings love and joy and peace and the message of hope to others, so that they too can come to know you even as we have. And may all that we do here and everywhere be to your praise and your glory. For we ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the same who taught his disciples when praying to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If you would stand as you're able, and join me in singing hymn number 136, The Birthday of a King. Ready to serve the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, loving your neighbor, sharing the good news of the gospel with them, that they too might come to know the joy of Christmas. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship and power of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.